On May 14, 1874, an urgent message was sent from the Imperial Palace in Beijing to Shen Baojian, Minister of the Naval Administration in Fuzhou, some 2,000 kilometers to the south. "We are informed of Japan's plan to occupy Taiwan," the emperor wrote, "which was and always will be Chinese territory." Shen received instructions to visit Taiwan and find out how to quietly deal with the crisis. Shen had long been aware of Japan's maritime threat. He had dedicated the previous 8 years of his life to building a modern navy for China. It now consisted of 15 ships built at his Foochow Arsenal and another 6 warships bought from yards overseas. But equally important, he had a cadre of foreign-trained Chinese naval officers capable of commanding these ships in battle. In December 1872, Japanese Foreign Minister Sojima Taniomi made a secret deal in Yokohama with the former American consul in Xiamen, Charles W. Legendre. Legendre was to be hired as a special advisor in both foreign affairs and military affairs, the first time the Japanese had employed a foreigner in this way. In 1867, as consul in Xiamen, Legendre had to deal with the Rover incident. The crew of an American ship, Rover, had been murdered by Taiwan aborigines in southern Taiwan after their vessel was wrecked. In dealing with the case, Legendre had become familiar with the Qing administration in the area. Now Japan needed someone who had experience of Taiwan, and Legendre was promised that he could become the governor of the island after a Japanese occupation.
本身的资源或者它的领土是有限的，所以它要积极的所谓对外扩张。那扩张的途径不外两种，一个就是所谓的“真海论”，就是以朝鲜半岛为跳板，然后向所谓的西方，就是他们以日本的观念是从向西边，以像朝鲜、像中国的华北或者是满蒙这一带做侵略。那南进就是以琉球为跳板，像台湾。
Ryukyu was an ancient kingdom which ruled over most of the Ryukyu Islands from the 15th to the 19th century. In 1372, Emperor Taizu of the Ming Dynasty officially recognized its status as China's tributary. The islands received aid from China and trade flourished. Ryukyuans studied at the Hanlin Academy in Beijing, and official documents and histories were written in Chinese. It was said that even the gates of Ryukyu's palaces were opened toward the west, the direction of China, to symbolize this attachment. According to historical records, from 1372 to the 1870s, China sent 24 envoys to Ryukyu to confer honorary titles on its vassals. The envoys usually sailed via the Diaoyu, Huangwei, and Chowei Islands to Okinawa and Ryukyu. In the 17th century, Japan began its expansion against Ryukyu. In 1609, the Tokugawa shogunate invaded the Ryukyu kingdom, and its king, Shonei, was taken as prisoner back to Japan. Ryukyu was thereafter forced to pay tribute to Japan. In September 1872, Ryukyu was subsumed into a Japanese prefecture. In October 1871, 4 Ryukyuan ships met a violent typhoon off the coast of Taiwan. One was lost at sea, and 2 were wrecked on the southern tip of the island. Initially sheltered by the Paiwan aborigines, when they tried to escape, they were attacked, and 54 of the shipwreck survivors were massacred. The event became known as the Mudan Incident. Since Ryukyu was by then occupied by Japan, the Japanese used the incident as a pretext to launch an expedition against Taiwan. The more so since the Qing government had rashly declared that the Taiwanese aborigines were beyond their sovereignty. With the Qing denying responsibility, the Gendre urged the Japanese to send troops to occupy the area. The Gendre provided the Japanese with maps and photos of Taiwan, marking out the territories of the aboriginal communities. The next year, the Japanese government came up with its general guidelines for the aboriginal communities in Taiwan. On May 6, 1874, Seigo Judo set off from Nagasaki with a Japanese expeditionary force of 3,600 men for the long-coveted Taiwan. The Gendre accompanied them as advisor. Between May 10th and 22nd, the Japanese landed in Pingtung, quickly crushing any aborigine resistance. The Japanese established a governorship in Guishan and began to build barracks and other facilities for a permanent occupation. When the news reached the Forbidden City, the Qing government, hitherto equivocal about the need for a modern navy, turned to the Fujian Naval Administration as the only means of dealing with the Japanese invasion. On May 29th, the court appointed Shen Baojian Inspector General for Coastal Defense and granted him a free hand on foreign affairs in relation to Taiwan. Geographically, Taiwan sat astride the sea routes from North and East China to the South and Southeast Asia. Its loss would be a great blow to Chinese interests and prestige. However, with China under threat from several different directions, Shen Baojian decided a negotiated settlement was the best solution to the issue. On June the 14th, Shen Baojian and his entourage, including French advisor Prosper Jaquel, set out from Fuzhou for Taiwan. They embark in a fleet of five of the Arsenal's new ships, with young officers like Liu Buchan, Sha Jianbing, Yan Fu, Wei Han, and Chen Jitong aboard. All were making their first steps on the world stage to put their new learning into practice. On June the 17th, the fleet arrived at Anping Fort in southern Taiwan. This far-flung corner of the empire was backward and crude, with desperately poor roads and limited communications. Shen Baojian immediately summoned the local Qing officials for a council of war. Cannons and powder were brought ashore from the fleet to boost defenses of the coastal forts. Meanwhile, in Beijing, Li Hongzheng had raised a force of 6,500 men to be dispatched with all speed to assist Shen Baojian.
He 也更不能侵略中国，另外呢，安民告示，就是跟这些投人呐，欢社的投人呐，建立一种关系，就是说我们会通过这种关系来帮助你们，是吧？所以很多这个欢社都规划了，是吧？而且表示说今后要善待海难的人。
In August, leading Japanese statesman Okubo Toshinichi arrived in China to negotiate a resolution to the situation.
中国的当时福建的船政舰队实力是远远高于他，而且日本在台湾当地还遇到了瘟疫。这时候日本人怎么办？这他就开始，就是选择了，就是按中国，就中国你给个台阶吧，我就下去了。
The British brokered a settlement by which Japan would withdraw from the island and would receive 500,000 taels of silver in compensation for the murdered Ryukyuan sailors. The British minister to Japan wryly expressed the view that this showed clearly China's willingness to pay to be invaded.
This 说明你把这些不会开船的孩子们都带出来，都能开船了，而且都能够按照你的要求把这个系统运行起来。The
Japanese forces withdrew, but Shen Baojian and his fleet decided to stay to bolster the island's defenses.
一块处女地怎么样给他做一个完整的施政的建设？我觉得他似乎是感觉到，这是他一生当中一个可贵的机会，他可以去施展他的抱负。他尤其认为说台湾的地位非常重要，所以福建巡抚根本就应该派来住在台湾。所以后来，叫做福建台湾巡抚，以前叫福建巡抚，后来有一阵子称福建巡抚、福建台湾巡抚。
There were no coastal defenses in Tainan when the Japanese landed, so Shen Baojian had built fortifications there and set up a new county government in the town.
Taiwan的行政区划也做了一些改革，一府四县三厅变成两府八县，啊，然后这个整个行政区划让台湾的经济重心在1860年之后慢慢的从台湾的南部，啊，往北部移。
After reorganizing the island's administration, Shen Baojian took steps to deal with the aboriginal communities in the mountains. Most aborigines lived in the mountainous regions of the east or south of the island and had little connection with the Han settlers who lived in the coastal areas of the west. 全保健 set about building roads through the mountains, deploying hundreds of men from the naval administration across the island to build three major roads.
在台湾年轻一辈都喜欢爬山，新横贯公路、八关古道都是在那个时候打开的。我们这个苏花公路的前身，南回公路的前身。 还有今天的新中横公路的前身，都是在他那个时候，啊，动用官兵人力，啊，把这个道路开发完成。所以，申宝森对台湾的建设是开先河。
In the Taiwan Library, one can still find the book that Shen Baojian personally compiled for the Aborigines. Wherever the road reached, so would Shen's education program, with schools for both children and adults. The literacy drive not only opened the road to practical skills in the three R's, but also to Chinese morals and customs about filial duty and the correct proprieties of relations between the sexes. Jaquel and his Naval Academy students produced China's first proper survey maps of the island. Unlike traditional Chinese maps, which were merely rough sketches, these used modern methods of scale measurement, which showed the precise layout of streets and districts.
跟他比对，他们的精确度非常高。简单的说，那个时候的传政学堂的学生，他们画这些图是真正科班出身，而且准确度相当高，就说已经他们的学习的水平，已经至少已经到达那个时候的绘图的一般世界的水平。
The students completed the map of the port of Anping independently of their instructors. It was the earliest 1 to 10,000 scale map produced on the island and clearly bears the names of the academy graduates.
To 要福建台湾的地方官员把这个地方的民俗风俗画图解说给皇帝了解，沈葆桢呢就把要画台湾原住民的这个图的任务呢揽下来，就叫他的这些就传承学堂的学生们去负责画这个图。
The illustrations showed different aspects of lifestyles of the indigenous ethnic groups on the island, together with the local flora and fauna. The students worked more than 6 months to complete them. The illustrations gave the late 19th century viewer an unparalleled insight into the lives of the island's natives. This map of the whole island is marked with Taiwan's position in terms of latitude and longitude. The map and the illustrations of each of the island's 36 indigenous minority groups are still all held in Beijing's Palace Museum. The Qing Wells was another development project undertaken by the students. Aware of the need for fuel for his ships and the industries that built them, Shen Baojian founded the state-owned Keelung coal mines, merging a scattered group of private mines together. He authorized academy graduates Che Jian Chuan, Lin Rajung, and Lin Qing Shen to acquire the latest mining equipment and technology from Britain. Qing Wells became China's first coal mine to use modern machinery.
陈葆桢呢，他们的师生啊，通过学到的知识，对台湾的建造化建设啊，发挥了重要的作用，特别是在工矿啊，这个电信电报啊，造船啊，翻译等方面都发挥了重要的作用，而且成为了台湾近代化的最早的一批技术骨干，啊，对台湾的近代化呢，是奠定的基础。
In July 1874, Chen Baojian took his students to the coast at Tam Shui to look at the possibility of establishing a telegraphic link between the island and the mainland at Fuzhou. The telegraph had been introduced to China after the Second Opium War. In contrast to the court conservatives, who rejected any modern inventions from the West, Chen Baojian was intrigued by its possibilities. In subsequent correspondence with Li Hongzheng, he repeatedly mentioned the importance of telegraphic communications between Taiwan and the mainland. As ever, whenever he discerned a need, the first thing he did was to get people in training. A year later, a school of telegraphy was added to the Naval Academy. It was China's very first telegraphic training school. By 1882, it had 140 graduates who would later become the founders of China's modern communications industry. In July 1887, a group of telegraphy graduates from the Naval Academy arrived in Taiwan. Their aim was to lay undersea telegraph lines across 117 nautical miles of the Taiwan Strait. On October the 11th, that year, the system entered service.
海底电缆的建设是很了不起的一件事情，在我们过场的电缆线路还没有开通的时候，沈葆桢跟他的后人已经在台湾建成了，所以以后呢，台湾的消息非常畅通，这也是宝岛台湾迈出的这个近代化的很重要的一步。等于说，在牡丹社事件之前，大清王朝对于台湾基本上是消极的姿态，为防台而姿态，并没有一个非常积极的。有效率的作为，那1874年之后，从沈葆桢，然后后来的丁日昌，乃至于后来刘铭传，等于说在自强运动后期、中后期最优秀的一批人才，干才都派到台湾来，使得台湾在整个自强运动中后期的现代化的历程里面，是领先内地的，而且有非常。
长足的一个进步发展，奠定了台湾现代化的一个基础。Chen Baojian governed Taiwan for exactly 380 days. In the verdict of Taiwan historian Li An Hing, Chen was a dynamic problem solver. Who built roads, settled the Aborigine peoples, and laid the foundation for future prosperity. There was almost nothing that was beyond him. Japan's incursion into Taiwan in 1874 had been a wake-up call to the Qing court. It settled the dispute about the value of a modern navy. Japan had been seen as a peripheral island state, but with a few ships, it had been able to occupy Taiwan. This was as humiliating to the court as it was shocking. Following the arbitrated settlement, coastal defense took on a new urgency. On his return to the Foochow Arsenal, Chen Baojian was faced with a new problem. The French engineers' and technicians' contracts had expired, and many had returned home. Imports from France were often delayed because of insufficient communications. Maintaining the effective running of the establishment without external help now became the top priority. It was then that graduates Wu Dejung and Lord Jun Lu presented to him plans for a ship of their own independent design. It was to be a 50-horsepower warship built from the remaining stocks in the warehouse. Impressed by their daring and initiative, Chen Baojian encouraged them to start work. However, lacking complete confidence in the outcome, he didn't even give the project a name. He said, "When the ship is built and successfully tested, we'll discuss how to name her." The ship turned out to be a success, and did so in less than a year. A well-satisfied Chen Baojian named the ship Yi Xin, meaning new craftsmanship. In May 1875, after months of deliberation, the Qing court decided to build two navies, the Northern Navy in the north and the Southern Navy in the south. Chen Baojian was named Minister of the Southern Navy, while Li Hongzhang, Minister of the Northern Navy. However, Chen seemed less than enthusiastic about this appointment. On one hand, he was exhausted by his exertions in Taiwan. And on the other hand, he was concerned about the future of the academy. To ease this concern, the court appointed Ding Racheng, another capable minister who supported the self-strengthening movement, to replace Chen at Fuzhou. Relieved, Chen Baojian accepted his new appointment and went to take up his post in Nanjing. China's two greatest enthusiasts for sea power were now set on parallel courses. However, a new problem soon emerged. How would it be possible to fund the building of two navies simultaneously? In late 1875, Chen wrote to Li Hongzhang, suggesting that the Northern Navy receive first priority since it protected North China and the imperial capital. If the funding is split between two, it will weaken both navies and impair the success of either one. Li Hongzhang was moved by Shen's selflessness. In preparing for his new navy, Li Hongzhang was faced with another difficulty, the scarcity of human resources. 1879, the warships he purchased were gradually being delivered, but he did not have enough qualified men to crew them. Chen Baojian made another suggestion. The new ships should be crewed by officers who had studied in the West and commanded by men who had shown courage and ability in battle. This idea married those Western-trained young officers with the older generation of officers who had real combat experience.
Li Hongzhang 就始终说了一句话嘛。后来李鸿章是受理办理那个北洋舰队，他就直接跟沈葆桢怎么说，在整个中国的官场上，这样的事情我只能请教于你。
Li Hongzheng followed Chen Baojian's suggestion by appointing Ding Rucheng, a famous general of the Huai Army, as commander of the Northern Navy, and recruited a group of young men who graduated from the Fuzhou Academy and had received their full training overseas. Among them were Liu Buchan and Lin Taizong, who were soon to write a training manual called On the Operation of Western Battleships and Batteries. They would go on to draft the regulation book for the Northern Navy. Lor Fun Lu, Sa Jian Bing, and 10 other academy graduates were given important positions in the Northern Navy. At the same time, Li Hongzheng transferred more than 20 young officers of the Fujian fleet to Northern. They constituted the core of this newly established modern Navy. In August 1881, Li Hongzheng set up the Northern Naval Academy at Dagu near Tianjin. Yen Fu, another Fuzhou graduate, was appointed the first dean of the English department a few months after he'd returned from Britain. The importance of education to China's very survival in such a fast-changing world preyed on the minds of the reformers. Sa Jian Bing emphasized stamina building in his training. He had a good rapport with his students and excelled at motivating them. He would lavish praise on anyone who made exceptional progress and even reward them with his personal possessions. He gave away both his pocket watch and his wicker chair to this end. Unsurprisingly, the Northern Academy adopted its teaching methods from Fuzhou. The year after it was established, an intake of students were transferred en masse from Fuzhou to Northern. The alien dialects of Fujian rattled through the air of the Northern Academy as they drank their oolong teas.
后来中国又出现了很多水师学堂，像天津水师学堂、江南水师学堂，或者广东的黄埔水师学堂也好，甚至于直到民国时期的海军学校也好，我们会惊讶地发现到一个事情，它的所有的学制的安排、课程的设置，基本都是按照船政学堂一脉相承继承过来的，所以船政几乎这个模式奠定了后来的上百年的中国海军的教育模式。
福建船政学堂它应该是中国近代海军的摇篮，也是整个中国海军在北方、在南方各个区域组建新式的海军部队的形成他们最初骨干的那个大本营。
In early 1881, a heated debate took place in the British Parliament over whether a Chinese fleet should be allowed to dock at British ports. This Chinese fleet consisted of two battle cruisers purchased from the UK. Previously, when China purchased warships from Europe, it would have to hire Westerners at no small cost to sail them to China. This time, Li Hongzheng wanted to send his own officers and crews to take possession of the vessels. In December 1880 and February 1881, Ding Wucheng, Lin Taizheng, Liu Buchan, and Deng Secheng were sent to the UK to take possession of the Yang Wei and the Chao Yang.
远航它实际表明了一种能力，表明了你的这个活动的这个范围，表明了你对这个可能发生的世界事物能否有能力取得发言权。所以呢，纽卡斯尔接舰这个事儿本身，不仅仅在于接回这两条舰，而在于它的这个象征的意义。
Li Hongzheng was a popular and respected figure among the British political establishment. The Parliament voted in favor of the Chinese naval officers' right to dock at British ports when taking their ships home. Thus, 264 Chinese naval officers and seamen arrived at Newcastle Docks on April 24th, 1881. Before their arrival, General Ding Wucheng had already been received by Queen Victoria and met with members of the Admiralty. It was a rare opportunity for the Chinese military leaders to have dialogue with their British counterparts. While in Newcastle, Ding Wucheng and Lin Taizheng were invited to attend a centenary celebration of George Stephenson, inventor of the first railway engine. At the reception, a British journalist started a conversation with Lin Taizheng. And when Lin said he came from Fujian, the journalist seemed nonplussed. Allegedly, Lin Taizheng explained, "It's the province where Lapsang Souchong, the black tea your royal family loves so much, is produced." Lin Taizheng then delivered an eloquent speech in perfect English, which impressed the assembled audience. So much so that the next day it was published in the local paper. Thus, the modern Chinese Navy made its first impressions on the West. While the Navy's new officers enjoyed the social whirl of Newcastle on Tyne, the 28-year-old Wei Han and his classmates, who had studied shipbuilding in France, were busy at work at the Foochow Arsenal's Design Institute. Their goal was to build a steel-hulled battlecruiser without any foreign assistance. The design was a modification of a French ship. Kaiji was China's first 2,200-ton cruiser, and it was launched in January 1883. The ship aroused such enthusiasm in China's coastal provinces that in less than a year, the governors of these provinces ordered four cruisers of similar design. On January 29th, 1888, Long Wei was launched. It was the first steel-hulled ship designed entirely by the Chinese. It incorporated the most advanced shipbuilding technologies found anywhere in the world. It was considered a great achievement. Long Wei was renamed as Ping Yuan and allocated to the Northern Navy. In the sea battle that was to come between China and Japan, the performance of the Ping Yuan was one of the few redeeming features of an otherwise desperate day. From the Yixin in 1876 to the Long Wei in 1888, the graduates of the Fuzhou Academy had indeed come a long way. They exemplified the potential energy and genius of a country sometimes derided as the sick man of Asia.
福州船运学堂呢，我们不能仅仅把它看成一个造船的一个工业学校或者一个海军学校，实际上它是在整个中国近代化的过程中，这个多方面的人才的培养，而且呢是应该说起了很重要的作用。除了这个军事人才，当然北洋海军的主要的厉害，海军除了好多海军司令都是这个。 还有就是工业建设，特别是造船和铁路，那么造船的很多这个造船工程师、很多科学家，从船政学堂培养出来。On
December 17th, 1888, the Northern Navy was officially established in Weihai in Shandong, with General Ding Rucheng as commander-in-chief. Liu Buchan was commander of the right squadron and captain of the Ding Yuan, and Lin Taizheng as commander of the left squadron and captain of the Zhen Yuan. Graduates from the Fuzhou Academy filled all the other important positions. Li Hongzheng more than once called the Fuzhou Academy the foundation of the Chinese Navy.
在中国海军有一个习惯，叫做无敏不成军，就是船政学堂呢，好像就是一个播种机，把一颗一颗的种子，这种海军的种子、技术的种子、近代化的种子，散播到了中国海防线上的每一个地方。
The Northern Navy with 25 ships and more than 4,000 men was considered the best in Asia. But when put to the test, nemesis loomed. All will be revealed in the next episode of the Foochow Arsenal. Within half an hour, one was almost completely destroyed. The reasons are controversial to this day. The war lasted 6 months. 11 ships' captains, all graduates of the Fuzhou Academy, went down with their commands. What had gone so wrong for the finest fleet in Asia?